Obviously, I've done it before. Right. Well, just to begin with, can I get from you, Karl, a definition of cryptozoology?
Cryptozoology is quite literally translated the study of hidden life or study of hidden animals, but more specifically, it's the scientific investigation of those animals which have yet to be verified or at least formally identified by science, by the scientific community.
What animals would this include?
They're a wide range. The famous ones that everyone thinks of, sea monsters, the Yeti, Bigfoot, dare I say it, the Loch Ness Monster, creatures like that. But also there are a lot of others. A huge species of vulture-like bird reported from North America, a strange dinosaur-like creature from the Congo swamps, and of course, famously, the big cats, which roam Great Britain and other parts of the world. So we're looking at quite a variety of different creatures. That's just a handful. There are about 300 on the type of general cryptozoological list of creatures we hope to discover at some stage in the future.
How much are, or how many of these are just pure myth and legend, and how many are real creatures that just are so elusive we haven't yet seen enough of them to be able to say they're there?
One of the big problems with cryptozoology is deciding which of the mystery animals on file are real but undiscovered and which are purely mythical. And the chances are, in most cases, they're a bit of both. Often, the local people in a given area of the world will report a dramatic creature, a dragon or a ferocious man-eating monster, something like that, which sounds like myth, sounds like legend, but when investigated, it's proven to be a real creature but elaborated by folklore and by superstition. The man-eating, flesh-eating ogres of Africa were actually discovered in the 1840s and found to be the gorilla, which of course are not man-eating or flesh-eating, but they are big. They do look ferocious. Their temperament is very different. But that was the basis of that legend. And then there was a forest donkey that lived in the Congo jungles. That was found to be the okapi, a short-necked giraffe. So we do. There is a type of almost a unicorn-like creature, two horns, but so close together, when viewed from the side, they look like one horn. Reported in Vietnam, and as recently as 1992, this was actually discovered by science, a totally new species related to the buffalo, but with long antelope-like horns, and that is the largest new animal to be discovered in 50 years. So often it's a mixture of both. Sometimes they're purely mythical. The creature behind us, you can probably see, the sphinx. I don't think that ever had a basis in life, but there are other creatures, other big cats around the world, which have been discovered. A creature that was said to be a cross between a hyena and a leopard. Total myth, total fantasy in what was then Rhodesia, now Zimbabwe, until 1926, when a skin was actually obtained of one, and it was found to be an abnormal form of cheetah, which we now call the king cheetah. So there was what seemed to be a legendary animal come to life.
Well, let's look at some of the British cases, particularly the cats. For how long have there been reports of very large wild cats still roaming in Britain?
In Britain, as far as the media was concerned, big cats appeared on the scene in the early 1960s with the Shooter's Hill Cheetah in London, the Surrey Puma, then moving forward to the 80s with the Exmoor Beast and things like that. But when you look through the files and the archives, you realise that this is not a new phenomenon. The reports go back many centuries. A panther in the grounds of Chillington Hall near Wolverhampton in the west.
I'm going to have to start again. You've got a pigeon in the background.
Oh, it's go... What does it matter?
Well, it's looking though. It was
oh,
very peculiar. Very peculiar. Right. Okay.
Well, which
so
one?
That
one.
Go back to Britain again.
The cat one.
Yeah. So, what about the big cats in Britain? How long have they been reported? What's the evidence behind it?
As far as the big cats in Britain are concerned, the media first decided they existed in the 1960s with the Shooter's Hill Cheetah in London, the Surrey Puma, then the Exmoor Beast in the 80s, and so on. But if you look through the archives, you find that they predate 1960 very considerably. Back as far as the 1500s, there was a panther roaming the grounds of Chillington Hall just outside Wolverhampton, which was shot when it attacked a lady. In 1760, the famous writer William Cobbett of Rural Rides, in fact he actually mentioned it in the book, encountered what he described as a very, very large cat in a tree in the grounds of Waverley Abbey in the Surrey area. And later on, when he moved to Canada, he saw a creature which fitted the description exactly. With the lynx. We don't have lynx, it's native to Britain, we haven't had them for 10,000 years. But he is absolutely convinced that what he saw in the tree as a child in Waverley Abbey was a lynx. And the Ennerdale or Gert dog from Cumberland eyewitnesses who saw it said that it wasn't a dog, it was a large lion-like cat. So it's not a new phenomenon. Media have latched onto it, but it's by no means a recent event.
How do you explain them? Are they native?
There have been lots of identities put forward as to what the cats are. Some very romantic, some very prosaic. Everything from a totally unknown cat to escapees. And from the descriptions of the cats, I favour the escapee identity, or identities, because they fit certain distinct categories. There's a large, 8 to 9 foot long, all black, very long tailed cat, Exmoor, Dartmoor, Bodmin has been reported, which fits identically with the Black Panther, which is the all black version of the leopard. Then there's another cat, a little smaller, not very much smaller, tawny brown or grey, which again fits pumas. A grey or yellow coloured cat, smaller than the puma and the panther, tufted ears, short tail, footprints left behind it. All of this match a lynx, and one or two smaller cats still. And of course, people say, well, eyewitnesses could be anything, which I suppose is true. Footprints are not conclusive, but what a lot of people don't realise is we have had bodies. About 16 bodies have turned up in 20 to 30 years, and they fit. They are, in fact, several different species.
But the cats that are reported, let's say in the southwest, over and over again, Exmoor, Beltman or whatever, would that be the same animal, or would there be families?
One of the problems is deciding with a given set of reports, whether we're talking about one specific animal, even if it's the same type of animal being reported, is it one individual, or is it a group of them? And one of the big problems in deciding is the fact that the big cats normally have very big distribution ranges or hunting ranges. They can cover hundreds of miles. So over a given period of time, if you have a succession of reports moving from one area to another, it could simply be one cat that is moving from one area to another, not necessarily a whole population. But having said that, there is increasing evidence that some of these cats that have escaped, have been released, are of the same species, are meeting and mating with one another. There are fairly good reports of big cats with cubs. Even footprints in the snow with a big cat and little footprints next to it. So I think that they have long lifespans, 10, 15, 20 years sometimes, so they have time to be in the wild to meet others of their own kind, opposite sexes obviously, mate and have cubs. So they could be beginning to establish themselves in the way that the wallaby, the Australian wallaby, established itself in the Peak District. Some of the Indian parakeets that escaped from aviaries, they now come to London bird tables. Porcupines on Dartmoor, scorpions on one of the Underground Railway Station tracks. You know, we've got quite a few aliens, as it were, from the animal world, and the big cats might just be yet another addition.
Is there sometimes a bit of wishful thinking that somebody will, say, take a photograph of a cat and it's actually not as big as the photograph makes it out to be?
Before we go on, do you want me to show this picture of it?
We're going to take that afterwards.
Right, okay. Yeah. Of course, the media hype for big cats has been such that sometimes, totally unconsciously, people start to see cats everywhere, particularly if they're in a given area where there have been a lot of reports, such as Bodmin, such as Exmoor, such as Dartmoor. If they see a cat-like creature, they take a photo, it's very tempting to assume that that's larger than it actually is. I mean, few people have the opportunity sometimes to actually go and measure the background detail to establish the exact size. They just trust their own judgment. And it has to be said, if you want to believe something, the brain is very good at making you believe it. Totally unconsciously, I'm not saying it's done deliberately, totally unconsciously. You can imagine things that aren't there, or you can expand things. You can turn a 2 foot cat into a 4 foot cat with great ease if you're unconscious, your subconscious wants you to do that.
And if you take a photograph, it's very easy to convince others.
Of course, the problem with photos is unless there is some way of, as I say, of measuring the background detail, it's not very easy to say how big a certain cat is, particularly if it's in the distance, if it's very close up for one thing. But famously, cryptozoological photos of little blobs in the distance, which could be any size at all. It can look like a big cat, but looking like one and being one are two very different things.